To 2 Timothy, the third chapter, and just pick up verse 16 and 17. Exodus, the 17th chapter, verse 8 through 13. I am doing everything I can to hold myself together.
All right,
every tea kettle should whistle at least once in a while. And every Christian should have a testimony that just percolates in you. Every once in a while, there should be something that God has done that you can't even talk about it. Oh, he should have been good to more than just two folk up in here. I'm trying to get through here. You're going to have to excuse me because God's been good to me. Talking about yesterday and yesteryear. God's been good to me today. Oh, I found the psalmist that he merely said, this is the day that the Lord has made. Oh, he did his part. Now my part, I will rejoice and be glad. Oh, you guys, I'm trying to keep my cool up in here. I got on this road, my wife bought it. I'm trying to look dignified, but when I think about the goodness of God and what he's done for me, my soul cries out. It don't take much for me. I don't apologize for it. I wish you could get to the place that you could claim God not has been, but God is good to me. Exodus, the 17th chapter, verse 8 through 13. Help me, Holy Spirit. You selected it, so I'm going to try to deal with it a little bit. It said, Then came Amalek and fought with Israel at Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, Choose us out men and go out and fight with Amalek tomorrow. I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. Watch what Joshua did. So Joshua did. Oh God, I wish I had a Joshua up in here. Joshua did as Moses had said to him. And fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand, the Israelites prevailed, and when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him. And he sat thereon, and Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands.
Yes, they did.
The one on the one side and the other on the other side. Tell somebody, get on your side. I'm going to be on my side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun.
All right.
And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Said he did some cutting. Now let me see if I can help you of how we can get there. Just two verses. Paul talking to Timothy. And as he was closing this third chapter. He said all scripture. Even the ones you don't like. Even the ones you tore out the book. Even the ones you scratched out. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Here's the good part for those who believe that. And it's profitable for doctrine. This is the part you won't like. For reproof. You're really not going to like this. For correction. Most of us don't like for instruction. And most of us can't stay in righteousness. Verse 17 closes. He said that the man of God, Zion Hill, you look here. Bethlehem, you look there. Rising stars, you look over there. Some of y'all are too hard-headed even to do that, but I'm going to talk about it anyway. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Before you sit down, I want to pose a question. Who will give the pastor a hand? Who will give the pastor a hand? I done listened to singing and enjoyed it. I haven't eaten, but I will enjoy that shortly. To this great culinary staff, to this great church under the leadership of my brother in this clarion call to tell dying men and women that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. My brother in this struggle, Reverend Booker T. Lewis, I want to say thank you for the invite to his most beautiful wife. It's good to see you. To these fellow clarion callers from a hill called Calvary, it's good to be here with you. The commentary is still the same. We will, before we leave here, find a way to the Via Dolorosa. Somebody ought to hear me. There's no sense in standing up if you're not pointing men to the Via Dolorosa. There's no sense in calling it preaching if Calvary isn't involved in it. Reverend, I stood at the door of dilemma looking at your scripture and think the Lord dropped me off where I can prayerfully meet that before I close. I want to pose the question, who will give the pastor a hand? But that's not the tag nor the title that I want to talk about. I do want to ask the question, who? While he attempts to get us back on track, I want to encourage you with the topic of subject of make the book talk. Reverend, if you want to find folk that's going to hold up your hands, you got to make the book talk. We've heard enough rhetorical communication from man. It's time to make the book talk. Oftentimes in the church setting, there are some, not all, who believe the pastor is supposed to do everything. They want him to teach, preach, sing, cook, visit the incarcerated, run the men's ministry, the women's ministry, run the missionary ministry, officiate choir fights, intervene with usher incidents, run all the ministries in the church, change the light bulbs, cut the grass, settle fights in the pews, parking lots, interpret your dreams and agree with your hunches, figure out how to pay bills when you won't pay tithes. Well, I thought I was back home until I looked up. Excuse me. I forgot I'm in Fresno and I don't want no problems up in here. Wanting to stand by the bedside of aging and stricken member that cannot understand when their spouse comes to church.
Come on, preacher.
Upset. You want us to do all of this and then you want to wonder why Tish looks so strange at some of you.
Come on,
I don't know about Tish, but I can tell you I didn't have to interpret Sister Hodge's dreams. I can share with you our conversations. You can't bother me without upsetting her. There's absolutely nothing wrong with the because he is trying to do everything in the church. He comes home at times after being neglected by the folks he's serving. Some of you would rather hug a snake and kiss a scorpion than support your pastor. We must continue to serve folk who stand face to face, curse at you while you're praying for them. Listen to members tell you, you treat that family better than you treat them. There's a very delicate balance that must be achieved as we try to move this thing along. As a matter of fact, if you want to know what the pastor's job is, you can look in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 11 and 12. The Bible said he gave some apostles and some prophets, some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. And the work is for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Our job is to get you in the position to serve God and not serve yourself. Somebody ought to say amen. My brothers and sisters, as we examine the text, we see the children of Israel.
Yes, sir.
They have just been refreshed by the water from the rock.
Yeah.
And as soon as it seems like it's smooth sailing, trouble arises. Has that ever happened to you?
Yeah.
Right after you believe it's smooth sailing, everything looked right. It's a few brothers up in here say, I remember that on my wedding day. It looked like I was going to be in bliss, but before the brothers talked too loud, and some sister said, if I done knew what that booger had in plan. Oh, I wouldn't have changed my name. I'd have changed my direction. Oh, the storm clouds come out of nowhere, and storms can be unpredictable. What starts out as a spring shower can turn into a major flood. Back home, what seemed like a few flurries can turn into a storm and escalate into a major snowstorm. And you never know how long the storm will last. And I don't care who you are and how much money you have in the bank. I don't care how smart you are. There are three types of people.
Come on, Bridget.
There are people that are in the storm. Those are the ones that will take help from any and everybody. There are some folk who are coming out the storm, and when they show up at church, they're on fire for the Lord. Then it's a few of you, the Lottie Dottie, looking for a party group. You always moving somewhere, but I stop by to tell you, on the way to Rodale, you're not in the storm. You're not coming out, but you're headed for a storm. Oh, the Bible said, man born of woman is of a few days and they are filled. Oh, there are storm clouds on the horizon. Not all trouble is to mess you up. Some is to push you back on course. It's about three folk up in here that can be honest and say, if I wouldn't have got in trouble, I wouldn't have bowed down and turned my life over to Jesus. It was trouble that I couldn't get out of. It was trouble that mama couldn't help me with. Daddy couldn't help. Oh, I had to turn it over to the Lord, and he worked it out. Some of us have been in dry places, couldn't find water, and God took you to the oasis of life. Well, I stopped by to tell you that Jesus will make a way.
He said,
don't worry about trouble. He let us know, Jesus said, in the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Not Buddha, not Elijah Muhammad, not Dionne Warwick and the psychic network, but Jesus Christ, the living God, is a bridge over troubled water. He's a shelter in the midst of a storm. Do I have two or three folk that can walk with me as the children of Israel were refreshing themselves Somebody say trouble.
Trouble.
Showed up in